his heart descend, it's really just full of sad betrayals and misplaced trust. And it can suck your spirit just as dry as dust, and steal your soul if you let it. Oh, every life contains its sorrows and pains, its stormy weather and its rough terrain. You watch me wrestle with my linked up chain, and smile so bravely as you tell me, don't lose heart, don't lose heart. Though it feels like yours will fall apart, just remember when the road gets dark, I will always be beside you. I've spent my life pursuing fortune and fame, chasing rainbows in a shadow. What I've lost is worth the gain. Oh, why my soul remains so restless. You've seen me stumble, Lord, you've seen me fall. You've shared my triumphs and you've seen me crawl. When I think that I could lose it all, you give me courage. Watch me wrestle with my link of chain, and smile so bravely as you tell me, don't lose heart, don't lose heart. Though it feels like yours will fall apart, just remember when the road gets dark, I will.
Thank you, Unity Band. As usual, you are outstanding. And we are grateful for you and for everybody else here. Good morning, Unity Myrtle Beach. Thanks for coming out here in this heat. After all, it is summer.
It has been confirmed.
Yes.
We have confirmed summer, according to our Right Reverend Margaret.
But we have air conditioning.
And we have air conditioning.
We have air conditioning. And we are grateful.
We are grateful.
I'm going to begin today with a prayer it begins with Dear God, and it was written by a lady by the name of Debbie Ford, who I didn't really know about until I did some research on her, but she was quite a woman, left us early because of cancer. So anyway, Ms. Ford gives us this. Dear God, on this day, I request you grant this request. I ask you to grant this request. May I know who I am and what I am every moment of every day. May I be a catalyst for light and love and bring inspiration to those whose eyes I meet. May I have the strength to stand tall in the face of conflict, and the courage to speak my voice even when I'm scared. May I have the humility to follow my heart and the passion to live my soul's desires. May I seek to know the highest truth and dismiss the gravitational pull of my lower self. May I embrace and love the totality of myself, my darkness as well as my light. May I be brave enough to hear my heart, to let it soften so that I may gracefully choose faith over fear. Today is my day to surrender anything that stands between the sacredness of my humanity and my divinity. May I be drenched in my holiness and engulfed by your love. May all else melt away. And so it is. Debbie Ford. We're going to be now entertained by the Unity Band again with We Shall Be Free.
This ain't coming from no prophet, just an ordinary man. But when I close my eyes, I see the way this world shall be when we all walk hand in hand.
Shall be free, and what I got from that song is that we're going to be free when everybody's free. So that's part of the equation, not just us, but everybody else as well. And we can do that as long as we're true to our heart, have the faith to do it.
Amen.
At this time, we're going to say the prayer of Jesus, the Lord's Prayer, translated from Aramaic. You'll find these on a little flyer in front of you or beside you. We will say it together.
Father, Mother, Birther, and Breath of All, create a space inside us and fill it with your presence. Let oneness now prevail. Your one desire then flows through ours as energy fills all form. Give us this day our physical and spiritual nourishment and untangle the knots of error that bind us as we release others. Do not let appearances make us forgetful of the source, but free us to act appropriately. From age to age, through you, flow the glorious harmonies of life. May these words be fertile statements through which our future grows. Amen, amen, and amen.
And now I'll read the daily word for Sunday, July 2nd, and I'll have to admit to you that our Reverend Margaret was very insightful, and before a board meeting last Tuesday, she says, I have something to read, and the word is guidance. So this is the second time I've heard it. Guidance. I'll say the affirmation, we'll say it again after the daily word. I seek trust and follow my guidance. I seek trust and follow my guidance. Seeking divine guidance means tuning out information and opinions and turning inward. Then, with an open heart and quiet mind, I can better feel the nudge of my intuition, my inner voice. I receive divine guidance much in the way flowers in a field soak up sunshine. Just as following the sun is innate for them, I have the instinct to trust my inner knowing. Even if my guidance surprises me, I trust it to lead me on the path to my highest good. I follow where I feel called to go. I heed the still small voice within and pay particular attention to the serendipitous circumstances I find along the way. I seek, trust, and follow my guidance. As I do, I deepen my relationship with God, knowing wherever I go, I do not travel alone. And from Isaiah 58, verse 11, the Lord will guide you continually. And here's our affirmation. I seek, trust, and follow my guidance.
I seek, trust, and follow my guidance.
At this time, we will have the Unity Band play our meditation song, and Reverend Margaret Hiller will come up for meditation and prayer. And afterwards, she will give us a message on transcendentalism, freedom, and new thought.
I am light.
the skin on the outside. I am not my age, my race, my soul inside is all right.
Everybody, that was beautiful. I didn't know your voice could go so low and strong at the same time. How many of us are surprised sometimes about the capacities we have that we didn't know we had? Anybody? You ever get surprised? I mean, what a surprise. Especially when we're walking through a hard time and we have our grieving hearts, our breaking hearts, and then we're surprised by this peace that passes all understanding. So where did that, how can I feel peace at a moment like this? So I was talking with Dan Haynes this morning about this very thing. We hold him in prayer. His beloved Cassandra is close to her passing time. And we talked about this idea of how we move through these days of our lives, these human experiences, and we feel our joy, our grief, our wonder, our consternation, our confusion, and yet, if we allow ourselves to do so, we tap into a peace that passes all understanding, beyond the circumstances, beyond the hard events of the human life. And we touch into something transcendent, something beyond what's breaking our hearts. And we're going to talk about that this morning. We're talking about unity's first principle today, which is God is everywhere and always present in everything, in everyone. And this energy is known by many names, and it underlies and animates all existence. So this morning, I invite you to take a deep breath. Another. And imagine breathing through your heart. Breathing in, feeling the breath of renewal move through you, feeling the breath of that river of life energy about which Jesus spoke. And as you continue your mindful breathing, I invite you to ponder the words of this meditation. I enter into the stillness to align myself with the one mind, the one presence that permeates all of creation. I feel myself as a part of this creation, connected to all of nature. I touch into the light, to the darkness. I am the oceans and the land. I am the rocks, the trees, the fish and birds, the beast of the earth, and I am one with every human being on the planet. In this oneness, I sense the order of all things. I feel the divine love that moves in me and in every molecule of the cosmos. I know the divine intelligence that is the foundation of all that is or ever will be is within me I am one with all. So take a few moments of stillness and silence. I invite us all to feel this presence that lives in all of creation. In this place of stillness, we feel the healing energy, the renewing energy of this beautiful Holy Spirit, this river of life energy, this one presence, the ground of all being. And we think of our beloveds near and far, Dan and Cassandra and all others who have written in for prayer, who have called in for prayer, all those beloveds that you hold in your hearts. We hold in consciousness with them that they feel this presence, this divine and loving presence of peace that surrounds us, that lives within every cell, every atom of our being. We pray that we all feel this presence. And we say, so it is, and so we let it be. Namaste. Ah. How does the temperature feel? Okay?
Perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect?
Yeah. Perfect, perfect is perfect.
I like it, yeah.
Yes, we have AC for all of you who are at home in your pajamas.
Yeah.
We know that many people are traveling, having their families come in for this July 4th weekend. So we give thanks for all of our blessings. This is an incredible idea that we are one with the all that is. And it's an idea that permeates every spiritual path, the indigenous paths, the great ancient ones knew this. They talked about it in many ways. Oh, thank you. I also have my gator, Chad. Thank you. Yes, everybody, here's the word for the day. Drink water, lots of it. So years ago, I was in Canada at an Ojibwe museum, and I saw this idea, being one with all that is, I saw it demonstrated in a mural. It was a round room and a rotunda, and everything morphed into everything else. It showed the fish morphing into the trees, into the birds, into the rocks, into the sky, into the humans. Everything was connected. And I just found myself turning. And then I saw someone watching me, an Ojibwe woman from a back room. And I was so curious. I went into the back room. You know, sometimes you have to go into the back rooms. And she was back there weaving with porcupine quills and sweetgrass. And she never said a word to me, but she wrapped up 12 packets of sweetgrass and gave them to me. And I looked at her companion, I said, what? She said, these are for you to distribute to the people that you feel should have them. And it took several months, but as I would meet with different people in different seminars, different healing sessions, I would be guided to give them a bundle of this sweetgrass. And I don't know what happened beyond there, but the connection of that Ojibwe woman with me and then with all of these others, you know, we never know how far our thoughts of healing and blessings go. We send our blessings out into the world, and then we let Spirit manage where that energy is used. Isn't that a wonderful thing to know? Well, sometimes when I feel that I'm not making a difference, or I meet with somebody who says, well, you know, what good does my life do? I hope and pray that every one of us can feel the pertinence of our lives, can feel the importance of our presence. Whether we ever leave our room and speak to anyone else, our thoughts, our ideas, our awareness is making a difference in the world. So we're talking about this energy that's everywhere present. The physicist Max Planck, the originator of quantum theory, he spoke of this energy. And he spoke of it as a conscious and intelligent mind that permeates everything. I wish I could have said in his science class. Wow, what would that have been like? So in scientific terms, it's the field of pure potential. It's the field of divine ideas. Fillmore called it the realm of divine ideas. So in science, it's the field of pure potential. Rumi talked about that field long before quantum theory was ever a term. He said, out beyond ideas of right and wrong, there's a field. I'll meet you there. You know, in a room full of theologians, if you've ever had that pleasure to be in a room full of people of different denominations and ideas about how it's all put together, this is a really good idea to remember. Out beyond all of our ideas about denominational differences and differences of religion and differences of culture, out beyond all that, there's a consciousness, a field. I'll meet you there. Let's meet there. Because that's where oneness is. That's the energy that the great ones, you and me, all of us, when we seek to move into the silence and the stillness, that's what we're really seeking. A place where we drop our opinions, we drop our fears, we drop our ideas of right and wrong, and we sit in the presence. We're talking about the all that is. The Bhagavad Gita says, by me is this entire universe pervaded. All things are in me and I in them. All things are pervaded, the entire universe, by this presence. The astronaut Edgar Mitchell called it nature's mind. And this brings us to transcendentalism. The whole idea that we don't ever have to walk into a church, we can walk out into nature and allow ourselves to feel the presence. Henry David Thoreau, Walden's Pond. You all know about this. To know God through nature. Charles Fillmore taught and practiced aligning with this presence in what? Silence, prayer, meditation. He also added in good works. So we align ourselves with the one presence through silence, prayer, meditation, and good works. Meaning, you know, doing something that's helping to lift the energy for one another. Fillmore taught so much about silence that he kind of gets the credit for that being one of the foundational principles of unity. And I just learned, and if this is true, and I'm going to think that it is, that it was actually Myrtle Fillmore who began to practice silence first. She discovered that the energy of healing and peace is in this silence. And then Fillmore, of course, seized on it. Charles seized on it and wrote about it and taught about it. Fillmore says, I enter into the stillness to align myself with the one mind, the one presence that permeates all of creation. Now, here's something that I've realized about myself as I approach my 75th rotation around the sun. I have to live in a certain amount of trust to even consider that it is true and possible that I can align myself with this one mind and this one present. I have to, when I sit in silence, I'm assuming, I'm trusting that this is true, that I can align with this presence that pervades all the universes we know about and the ones we don't know about yet. I can align with that. How do you feel about that? Do you feel that you can align with this one presence, this divine intelligence? Yes. Oh, please, somebody say yes.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, that's what unity's based on. But we have to have a certain amount of trust, a certain amount of awareness to even give ourselves over to aligning with this presence. Several years ago, I was up at Unity Village, or over at Unity Village, working on my leadership training for licensed Unity teacher. And one of the things we got to do was go into the offices of Myrtle Fillmore and Charles Fillmore. And about eight of us sat in Charles's office and we meditated together. And during the meditation, during the silence, I felt the room filling up and I thought, well, there must be a few other classes coming in. It was feeling kind of, you know, tight. There was a lot of people in that room. And about 20 minutes passed, and when I opened my eyes, I was in there all by myself. How do you explain that, Lucy? So the idea that energy is palpable and it can be retained in a place, I don't know, that's one way to explain it. Energy cannot be destroyed, it can change shape, but the idea is the energy of peace and silence and stillness was so palpable in that tiny little office. Your energy of peace, of healing, of transcendence continues to stay in a place, I feel, I believe, even after you go. So we're talking about aligning ourselves with this one mind, this one presence. I mean, that's quite a spiritual practice. You know, I don't ask anyone anymore, what religion are you? I stopped that a long time ago. But I am interested in spiritual practice. You know, how do you align with the one presence, especially when things feel hard? How do you align with one presence? Another way to speak about this is when we're aligning with this presence, we're actually transcending the physical, ordinary dimension. We can sense the transcendent. We can even feel ourselves a part of this transcendent dimension, this realm that Fillmore called Realm of Divine Ideas. And there's a whole movement back in the 1820s, 30s, 40s, speaking to this idea called Transcendentalism. Ralph Waldo Emerson, how much fun would it have been to meet him back then? Transcendentalism arose, and I'm sure there's scholars out here who can speak to this maybe far better than I, so if you have any clarification, you know how it works here, just speak it out. Transcendentalism, a philosophical movement developed in 1820s, 1830s, 40s in the eastern U.S. We know it's Massachusetts, New Hampshire, up that way, where there were people like the Alcott family, Louisa May Alcott, Henry David Thoreau, Margaret Fuller, lots of people whose names we associate with the abolitionist movement, the anti-slavery movement, the Underground Railroad. Transcendentalism arose as a reaction to protest against the general state of culture and society at the time. Seems like we're still there. So it's a protest against the general state of culture, society at that time, slavery being one of the big parts, and the state of intellectualism at Harvard University and the Divinity School, because what was being taught there was Unitarianism. And Ralph Waldo Emerson, son of a Unitarian minister, he had the audacity to stand up at Harvard Divinity School and say, you people have lost the spirit. I mean, that's basically what he said. You're all in your heads. You know, intellectualism is a lovely thing, but you've forgotten how to use your intuition, how to use your heart, how to connect with this presence. Can you imagine? And so they decided that he needed to leave. They did, however, invite him back in 1838 to give a commencement exercise, which is fun to think about. And he did it again. He once again said, you've lost the spirit. You need to be teaching people that they can access this presence within themselves, and they don't have to do it in a church. Well, he's invited to leave again. Yeah. He said, you don't have to do this in a church. You don't have to do it through a priest or a minister. You can access this transcendent realm on your own, through your own consciousness. You can do this. He also wrote about the Oversoul, an essay that explores the spiritual unity of all of you with the all that is. He spoke of a divine presence within each person. Does this sound familiar? It's foundational unity principles. And our founders certainly would have been reading the Transcendentalist. The Oversoul, the divine presence within each person, connects all living beings to one another and to the whole universe. In this essay, he outlines his belief in a God who resides in each of us and whom we can communicate with. And again, he noted, without membership in a church or the assistance of an intermediary church official. Again, this does not sit well with traditional religion. And by the way, in these days, you know, 1838, that's when England outlawed slavery. And the abolitionist movement was in full throttle. And the transcendentalist said, this one presence resides in everyone, no exceptions. This was a bold way of thinking in this country. And this is the foundation on which New Thought has grown out of. Now, when I'm getting ready to teach a class, foundational unity class, about New Thought, about unity. And this is just one of the books that goes into the history and the unfoldment of what's come to be known as the New Thought movement. This is not a little book. It could be used as a doorstop. And the print is small. A lot of writers, philosophers, scientists had a part in creating what you and I have come to know as the New Thought movement. Now, this is something fun. The New Thought movement first was called the New School. And then they changed the name to Disciples of Newness. And then they changed the name to the Symposium. They were thinkers gathering usually at the home of Ralph Waldo Emerson. Interesting little note, Henry David Thoreau was their handyman for the Emerson family, and he sat out in the little foyer and listened while the other intellectuals were talking amongst themselves in the parlor. Henry David Thoreau, though, ended up being the person to put into practice what the transcendentalists were talking about. At one time, they were called the Hedges Club because they met at a house that was called the Hedges House. It's funny that they came to be known as transcendentalists, the early forerunners of New Thought. Transcendentalist, that name was given to them by the Unitarians. And it was meant to be disparaging, apparently. You transcendentalists, you don't have your feet on the ground, your head's in the clouds, You're not paying enough attention to science, to John Locke, to the way things work in the universe. The transcendentalists say, well, that's all fine, but we want to include the intuition, what goes beyond the senses. This movement, this transcendentalist movement, and what has become known as New Thought, was unfolding before the Civil War, during and after the Civil War. The abolition of slavery, they were known as free thinkers, they were part of the Underground Railroad, advocates for human rights. And Henry David Thoreau said, here's how we do it. Let's find a way to live simply in natural surroundings and let the power of nature guide us to feel the one presence. It's one of the reasons so many of us are happy to be out here now instead of the old building in the industrial park. And we love that building too, but here we are, letting nature be a part of our spiritual experience.
Amen.
So, New Thought, Transcendentalism, what this movement, Unity, sits on top of, was deeply influenced by Indian philosophy, specifically Vedanta and the Vedas and the Bhagavad Gita. Emerson drew inspiration from Plato and Plotinus and Emanuel Swedenborg. There's lots of rich ideas within this movement. We live, Emerson said, we live in succession, in division, in parts, in particles. Meantime, within humankind is the soul of everything. The wise silence, the universal beauty, to which every part and particle is equally related. He's talking about the oversoul, and he used terms like equally related, talking about everyone. No one excluded. So the backdrop of New Thought, the idea of freedom, the idea of human rights, the idea of freedom in religious thought. Now, in this little book that we're going to start using in our Wednesday book group week after next, The Five Principles, there's a question that this author asked, Ellen Debenport, used to be a newspaper reporter. She asked this question, so are we allowed to make up our own God? Are we allowed to make up our own religion? And she says, of course, it's called theology. The study of the divine and its relationship to the world. Now think about it. How did you learn about religion? How did you learn about God? For most of us, we were told about what God is, how God works. We were told how it works with punishment and reward, being saved or not saved. Someone told us. So New Thought comes along, Transcendentalists come along and says, well, we've been making all of this up, humankind, as we go. And then we made it into dogma and into rules, and decided who was doing it right and who wasn't. And Transcendentalism and New Thought says, go within, receive your divine inspiration, intuition, guidance, and connect with this one presence in the way your heart guides you to do. That's harder in some ways than being told what to think.
Much harder.
Much harder. We're told what to think in dogmatic religion. New Thought spirituality says you have this capacity to connect with this one presence, and you are given the freedom. You have the freedom to worship or connect or to align with this one presence in the way your heart tells you to do. It's the freedom to go beyond the intellect. It's the freedom to know a mystical, spiritual connection with the One Presence. It's the freedom to receive our own revelations and inspirations. I remember saying that a few years ago in a seminar. I said, well, you know, we're intended to receive our own revelations. And the woman said, you mean like revelations in the Bible? I said, yes. She said, well, that is the revelations. I said, yeah, 2,000 years ago, my God's been at work for the last 2,000 years, finding other ways to reveal to humanity
Amen.
Who we really are and what is the truth that lives within us. Charles Fillmore wrote, and I love him for saying this, I reserve the right to change my mind as there are new scientific discoveries and new spiritual insights. In other words, you have aligned yourself with a spiritual movement called unity, which is a part of new thought, which grew out of things like transcendentalism. You've aligned with that. And you've aligned with a movement that explores how spirituality continues to unfold through us as a species. You're aligned with a movement that welcomes new ideas, new revelations, and new insights. I think you should congratulate yourself. So, principle number one affirms that God is all there is. And affirms that God is omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent. And this writer says, God is not all-powerful, but all-power. God is not all-knowing, but all-knowledge, and present everywhere. And sometimes you hear bells to go with that. God is the stars, the rocks, the animals, the people. God is the love, the creativity, the wisdom that human beings express. All that we are and have is God, and we can never be separate from that universal power. And thus it is, amen. We can never be separate from that power. Years ago, I was called to the bedside of a Baptist minister. I did not know him. I did not know his family, except one person who knew me through somebody else and called and said, can you come and talk with our father? He's in his dying time. So I go to this man's bedside, and being partly raised Southern Baptist, I kind of knew what his theology was. He was in and out of consciousness, and he said to me at one point, is any of it true? It was not a time for me to say, well, please say more. What do you mean? This man was in and out of consciousness. So I did what we can all do, which is ask, what do I say? What's the answer? And I heard myself say, as I was saying it, everything that's about love is true. Amen. Now think about Southern Baptist theology. He had been taught, and he probably preached a lot on the idea that we're born in sin, and if we're not good enough, we're going to go to a very hot place where there's no air conditioning. I pretty much knew his theology. Everything that's about love is true. He relaxed. I felt peace. Felt peace in the room. He passed a few hours later, and I have a feeling that that answer helped him to cross, knowing he was loved and knowing the peace of this one presence. It's as simple as that. Ask, what is the best and right action in this moment? What's the best thing to say in this moment? What's the best response in this moment so that I can be a part of generating peace and healing? So Wordsworth talked about this presence. And I wrote this down fast last night as I was listening to someone recite it. And I wrote in shorthand, so I'm going to pray. Y'all pray with me. I can still read my shorthand. Wordsworth said this, "I have felt a presence that disturbs me with the joy of elevated thoughts. A sense sublime of something far more deeply interfused, in whose dwelling is the light of setting suns and the round ocean and the living air and the blue sky, and in the mind of humankind, a motion, a spirit that impels all thinking things, all objects of all thought, and rolls through the life of all things."
Mm. Woohoo! Beautiful.
I know, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So the Unity Convention was last week in Kansas City. And I've been getting messages from some of our friends that were attending the convention. And one of the speakers is a New Thought minister named Mark Hicks. He was one of the keynotes. And if you want to check into him, he has done huge amounts of research in New Thought and Unity. Wonderful teacher. TruthUnity.net is the website. So I've asked this question a few times here, and actually recently. The question is unity Christian? Yes, we are based on the teachings of Jesus. Yes, our founders were Christian. And yes, we honor and celebrate all spiritual paths that are open to the truth and the teaching that the divine is living within us, around us. We're all connected. So there was a dialogue at the convention because Mark Hicks asked this question, how do we describe ourselves? How do we give the elevator speech to someone that says, what is unity? And his new term that he's using, metaphysical Christianity. Well, the dialogue is on his website if you want to listen to it, because it brought up and stirred up a lot of dialogue at the convention. What do we call ourselves? What is unity? I'm hoping somebody has the answer.
So, Reverend, if I may, because I've done this elevator speech recently,
right,
over the last couple of months a lot, and I say the biggest difference between traditional Christianity, and I was raised Catholic, actually I was raised a half-breed, Catholic and Nazarene, okay? And for those of you that don't know Nazarenes, Nazarenes make Southern Baptists look mellow. And my grandfather was a Nazarene minister. So the biggest difference that I discovered, and I discovered unity, oh, I discovered Margaret and unity in 2006. You have to want to be like Jesus. Unity teaches that action is needed, and that's another unity principle that we'll get to.
Yes.
But that's the biggest difference. Okay, the way that I was raised, you are saved, you are going to heaven, and it's magic. You don't have to be a good person anymore because you've been saved. And unity teaches that you actually have to want to be like the prophets. Anyone. It could be Jesus, it could be Muhammad, but all of those people, you have to want to get there. And to me, that's the biggest difference between unity and traditional Christianity.
In other words, do this yourself, don't wait for somebody else to do it for you.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's the actual teachings of Jesus.
Yes, you can do all the things I have done and greater.
Yes.
Thank you, Reverend.
Margaret,
yes.
I think of the prayer of Jesus where he said, I would that you would all be one, even as the Father and I am one.
Speak into a mic. Just go over there with Pam and get that mic. Because the rest of them can't hear you.
I said, I think of what Jesus taught when he said, I would that you all would be one, even as the Father and I are one. So that's what you mean. Being one.
Right. Being one with God and with each other. So I hope that you can feel something good about aligning yourself with this idea that we have been created to know oneness with the one presence, the all that is, and to feel oneness with one another. And when that happens, it's harder to be at war with another culture, another religion, another group. It's hard to move into hatefulness or unkindness when you have begun living in the awareness that there's no one excluded from the oneness. I know it's true because we have it right up here on this plaque, if I ever forget. God bless the whole world, no exceptions. That's what the New Thought movement is about. Now, then began the work of living the teachings, and Anton's right, that's principle number 5. We don't have to worry about that one for a little while. Several years ago, in the way back, actually, about 09, there was a leadership training at Unity of Raleigh, and I went with the then board president, Jenny Miller, some of you remember her, and some of our board members, and the speaker, the seminar leader, was Simmons, Gary Simmons, who you know possibly from the book The Eye of the Storm. And I stood up and asked a question. He said, well, what church are you from? And I said, at that time, our name, Unity Christ Church in Myrtle Beach. And then what the board president said, well, it's Unity Christ Church of the Grand Strand. And then one of the other people stood up and said, well, now we just call ourselves Unity. And Gary said, if you don't know your name, how's anybody else going to know your name? Now, it's interesting to me that the Unity movement is still trying to decide what our name is. We're still trying to decide what to call this movement, this idea. And we just boil it down to unity. Oneness.
Yeah.
One presence within you, within me. Oneness with the all that is, with one another. Unity. And it's still being discussed. Is unity Christian movement or not? So here's what I've whittled it down to, and it's pretty much what Anton just said. If I'm attempting to have the consciousness as demonstrated by this one we know as Jesus Christ, if I'm even making an attempt to have and live in that kind of consciousness, then I am doing just fine, whether I'm inside of a church or outside of a church. And I'm doing just fine whether I call this presence Jesus or not. If I can know this one presence, I might not ever have heard of the name Jesus, but knowing this one presence, that's the gift of being human. That's why we've been created, to know our oneness with this one presence. Whether you do it in a Christian church, a Unity church, a Religious Science church, a Catholic church, a mosque, a synagogue, a teepee, a pavilion. And we humans have spent so much time and energy on debating and arguing about what's true and not true, and we've forgotten to feel the spirit and to feel our connection with it. And that's what Ralph Waldo Emerson told Harvard Divinity School. God bless you, Ralph. So let's take a deep breath. Think about all the places your religious training has taken you, your spiritual quest, your spiritual exploration. Think about all the places your heart has taken you in this journey of sensing your light and your connection with this one presence. Think about the moments where your heart, your mind knew that there was so much more to understand. And you opened your heart and your mind to receiving inspiration and revelation, understanding. This is the gift of being human. Whether we do this in a church or on a mountain, in a garden, in the quietness of our own home, our own place of prayer and meditation, the point is, let yourself feel the one presence that transcends all human activity. And we say, so it is, and so we let it be. Namaste.
Namaste.
Absolutely your best. In my opinion. I want to add to that something I've been thinking about for a long time. I think what happened to the teachings of Jesus in the church that I've been affiliated with, both Baptist and Unity, was a movement from following Jesus, trying to live those principles, to a belief that he died to redeem us from sin. You know, and that became, the principal part of the, at least the evangelical movement, rather than the following of Jesus and his teachings, became something that he did on our behalf. So that if we acknowledge that, then we're okay. And if we don't acknowledge that, we're not. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was, that's a big error. And so anyhow, my 2 cents worth added to what you were saying is just absolutely perfect. Let's take our tithes and offerings and hold them in our hand. This is probably the second most important part of the service. You know, many of us volunteer, work out here, and do all kinds of things, and some of us can't because we have jobs and we're working. And of course, you make some money when you have a job. And some of us are just not able to do that. But you're all able to be a part of this service by giving, giving joyously and peacefully. So let's take our tithes and offerings, hold them in our hand, and give our blessing to them. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for the way in which we have been blessed and the blessings that we have received even here today, and for the continuous flow of divine energy through our lives. Thank you, God. And so it is. Amen.
Amen. Okay, we have a song. Here we go.
Yeah.
you can with what you have, in the time you have, in the place you are. Do all you can. Do all you can.
Divine energy moving through this ministry, doing His perfect work, doing all we can to bring about a message of hope and love and peace to the world. And then see it returning to each giver, heaped up, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Thank you, God. And so it is. Amen.
Amen.
All righty. Thank you, everybody. And we want to welcome everybody here, and especially those who are here for the first time. And I know that Bob Shipman family is here. You want to stand and introduce them all, Bob?
Sure. I'd be happy to. This is my brother, Rick, whose birthday is tomorrow.
Oh.
My sister, Susan.
Oh.
And my sister-in-law, Lisa, who is Rick's wife.
Welcome everyone. Any other first-time visitors here today? All righty, there is a prayer box back here on the back table for you to put in your prayer request. Tomorrow night, there will be a First Monday Song Circle. Anton and Dave Lacombe, so bring your instruments, your voice, your music. Tuesday evening metaphysics with Reverend Marilyn Maddox is going on Zoom, Tuesday night, 6:30 to 7:30. And Wednesday book group, 12 to 1:30. We have one more week with our resilience book, and then we start our new book, Unity's Five Principles.
Marilyn will not be doing metaphysics this Tuesday. It's the 4th of July.
All right. I did not hear from her on that. So.
I asked her for general reminder. I didn't put it in general reminder.
Okay, so I don't know everything around here, evidently. Wednesday book group will happen, 12 to 1:30. Friday night, July 7th, is the fire ceremony. Anton Knoll is facilitating that for blessing of our planet and our waters. And the flyers for the fire ceremony are back there on the back table. You can ask Anton about it if you have questions. So what we've launched today is a summer series. I'm calling it Spiritual Pathways to Peace. We're starting with the Unity Principles. So next Sunday, I'll be your speaker again, and we'll be speaking on the Unity Principle number 2, human beings are innately good. So when someone gets put out with you and upset, all you have to say, I am innately good. It works, doesn't it, honey? Okay. So that's next Sunday. There is a new July month at a glance on the back table. It tells you everything you ever wanted to know, plus some, including you also have back on the back table our community outreach list that Darylyn's put together for us, three groups that we support, not only with some of our tithes, but with supplies to Family Justice Center, Help for Kids, and the Boys and Girls Club. So that list is back here, and your help is very appreciated. So finally, the a class that I'm gonna be doing in July, I know that everyone is a member of this community, and some of you want to be voting members. as a nonprofit, as a church, we have bylaws, and in those bylaws, to be a voting member, you need to do a few things. One, regular attendance at Unity Myrtle Beach for at least 1 year. To attend at least one Unity class where foundational Unity teachings are covered, and then to complete an application, and to give us your blood work and your fight. No, just the regular, the attendance for 1 year at least, and then a class on foundational Unity principles and an application. Now there's two ways you can fulfill the class requirement, and the flyer's back on the back table for you to review. Two ways you can fulfill the class requirement. Come to the Wednesday book group regularly as we do the Unity 5 principles, or take the Foundations of Unity class via Zoom for three Thursdays. That's July 13th, 20th, and 27th. Making it easy, the comfort of your own home, and you can fulfill the class requirement. So that's on the back table. And finally, potluck today, everybody's invited. Whether you brought something or not, please join us. And I want to read our July birthdays. Jesus, I hope you're watching. I'm remembering to do this. Okay, July birthdays, not only Rick Shipman, but Bob Shipman. July 4th is his birthday. Damn. Brittany Evans, Tammy Perez. No, another Tammy. And David Hiller. Okay, so everybody's welcome to potluck. Happy birthday, everybody. Happy birthday, us. So let's go into our updated prayer of unity, and then our peace song, and then the potluck. And if you're too warm eating in the barn, you can go in the house. You can come back in here. You can go sit under a shade tree. Y'all know how to take care of yourself. So, updated prayer of unity. The light of God surrounds us. The presence of love enfolds us, the power of peace protects us, and the one presence that lives within all creation enlivens us. Wherever we are, love is, peace is, light is, God is, and all is well. And that's the truth. Let's stand for our peace song.